Hi, Brian. How are you?
Hey, how you doing, Jason?
I'm okay. I'm setting things up here.
Okay.
I read a quote that you had written or stated, and in reference to OGWB, you said, if you never went to jail, you'd still be here. Can you explain that quote?
Yeah, I just feel like he probably went along with those other laws. I don't know what really cut it out, because I was locked up, but not a street back to the story. But I did not even be willing to be out and be over that way.
Now, in reference to OGWB, what's your favorite memory of it?
It's a good, hard working thing, any time, but. It's a good thing, man. Like, they don't even really make me anymore there no more. Like, the streets really, like, you get crossed out right now because someone's bullshit, man. But, I mean, that's not the first really good thing. But, you want to see a nigga make it too, you feel me? And you really just get to make a game. He from the old school, you feel me? Like, he got a real game. So, he really just schooled me, like, getting me the whole lot of game. Like, he taught me a lot of game. But, I never forget, I still need to do that.
Hi all, hi everybody. I'm setting things up here, so
okay.
Hey boss. Boss.
Hi Stefan.
Thank you. You know that I'm here on time today. I came on time especially for you. Brian, what's good, bro?
Yo, what's good, Steph? I miss you, man.
I'm good. I miss you too, bro. How's things going? How's everything going? See, you campaigning in the supermarkets, delis, across the city. Campaign's going worldwide, huh?
Nah. Yeah, I'm trying, man. A lot of people don't really want to speak because, you know, under the circumstances, unless they by themselves. But it's like, you know, it is what it is.
Speak your truth, brother. Speak your truth. Maritza, how are you?
I'm good. And you?
I'm good. I miss you, Maritza. How's it going? How's your family?
Well, my family, we're doing good. We're trying to, you know, stay positive during this pandemic. We're trying to keep each other safe. My house is stacked up. I've been working like crazy hours in the supermarket, you know, providing for the community and me. But I'm still doing good. I'm still balancing my classes. So, yeah. And I'm also like making sure that I'm doing my transfer application as well, that I have a smooth transfer for the going to Lehman. So far I'm communicating with them.
Sounds dope. Mr. Yeah. Liffeld, can you tell us why there's two of you, sir? And why are you at work? You're supposed to be socially distanced from work. Like, why are you at the office? This is not fair. Professor Cyril.
Hi, Cyril. How are
you? He has to unmute his mic.
He definitely has to unmute his mic, and he knows this.
Hi, guys. How are you doing today?
A lot of background noise over here. What is that?
Oh, yeah.
Mr. Professor Cyril.
Oh, Alyssa. Alyssa is connected.
She says hey. You couldn't hear her because she's in my ear, but she said hey.
Thank you. Hi, Jason. How you doing?
Hi, Brian. Put you down?
I'm sorry, I'm on time.
No, not every presenter is on time, so, you know, we thank you for being on time.
Have to figure out.
How's the family doing, Jason?
We're okay. Just, you know, two host those offices in the same house is a little tough.
Yeah.
You know, scholarships and leadership is, you know, we butt heads sometimes.
Hello, Brian.
Hello. How are you?
I'm doing good. And you?
I'm okay. I can't complain, man. Under the circumstances.
Nice.
I don't look like I'm in my chair.
I can't wait till this workshop gets started, man. I know you're going to be very inspirational, man. As you should.
That's what they say, man. I don't know. That's what Jason says.
Okay. So I have to admit everybody, so I'm going to be doing that.
Okay.
Oh, shoot.
Hi, people.
Hi, Sakina.
Don't mind me, just taking out my hair.
Taking off your hair?
Take it out, sir.
So, Sakina. I started the recording when I came on, Sorrel, so let's give it a couple more minutes, see how many people pop on, like by 3:35, and then once that hits, you can go.
All right, that's cool.
Yeah. And don't mind the two of me. I'm watching on the laptop, and I'm on my cell phone, so you guys can see me. I feel bad when people can't see me, so.
Oh, okay.
Two things here.
Yeah, you feel bad when we can't see you either, boss.
Hello, Luz.
And that's Miles. If I can fix that.
Been a long time no see. Hi.
Hey, Sakina. How you doing?
I'm well, and you?
I'm doing great.
Makai.
Hello.
You want to say hi? Say hi.
Hi.
Makai.
Who is this?
I'm going to do a meeting, okay?
Hi, Stefan.
Hi, Makai. How are you?
He's
coming.
Hello, Miles.
Hey.
Oh,
it's Miles.
What's up, Sir? Miles.
Hey, Moise.
How are you?
I'm doing good. And you?
I'm all right. Hello, everybody.
Moise. What's up, man?
What's up, Brian? How you doing, Stefan?
I'm good, bro. I'm good. I'm great, man.
Glad to hear that. Glad to hear that.
Got a lot of rest today. Ignored my phone for 24 hours. It was great. It was a great day.
That's what's up. That's exactly what's up.
I know, brother. I know.
Oh, my God. Jason's baby.
No, Jason, don't do that. That baby does not need glasses. No. Do not try to transfer your stuff on the baby, please. That baby is healthy. Boys, how's your day going so far?
It has been involved with a lot of things that I cannot discuss on this platform. So you know what I'm talking about, but I've been very busy. Okay. That I cannot discuss on this platform. And right. I'm trying to keep mentally stable. I can't wait for tomorrow.
Yeah.
And I was looking forward to this because I knew your knowledge with the rest of the SLA. I can't wait for them to get half of what we get on a regular basis. So
right.
Very eventful day for us. And I can't wait.
That's cool. Me too. Due to people like Stefan, who could not meet yesterday, so blame him.
I'm sorry, sir. I do want to apologize. I had to work late night last night. I had a lot of responsibilities that I've been putting off, you know, for things that I can't mention on this platform. So I wanted to make sure.
I did not ask you to justify yourself. I just said you should get the blame. That's all I'm saying.
I mean, I was number one. I heard there was like five other people that couldn't make it, so I shouldn't absorb all the responsibility.
That's how powerful you are. As soon as you say you could not make it, everybody just followed you.
Let me ask Alyssa this question. Alyssa, am I that powerful that I said I'm not coming to the meeting yesterday and everybody else was like, "No, we're not doing it either"?
Wait, what?
She's no, like, that's wrong. Not answering that question.
That is totally wrong.
All right, it's 3:36.
All right.
Happy birthday, Gabriel.
So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna can I mute everybody so that you can talk? I'm gonna mute Gabriel and let you talk.
All right. I would like to say hi to everybody. And I'll call you by name. Moving from my left to my right, I want to say hi to Brian Carter. And if it's not your right name, just make a sign so that I should know. But I like to address people by their name. So Brian Carter, hi. Stefan Jivela, hi. Moise Agbaje, hi. Sakina, hi. And can you please sit in front of the screen so that we can have this connection? Thank you, so that we can look at each other's face. Jason Lipfield, hi. Tiana Cordero, hi. And I think those cookies that you're eating are so sweet because I see the way you're enjoying them. Kabirat Abioye, hi. It's been a while and I'm so happy to see you. And I hope your family is doing great. Luz Lady Perez, hi. How you doing? Stephanie, how are you doing? Marita Martinez, I hope you're doing okay. Serge Galbani, I hope you're doing all right. I love your profile picture. I'm a pro-African myself.
Thank you, man.
Yanira, I hope you're doing all right. I hope all of you guys are being safe. I hope you're following the guidelines for not being a statistic. Because as we all know, when you become a statistic, that's it, right? It's not even like we could have the power or the ability to come and say goodbye to you for the last time. Now they have a lot of portable mugs in front of the hospitals where anything happened, they just pack you in there. And then they're doing a lot of mass graves around the cities where they bury people that don't have family that will come and claim them. Tiana, who is that? Tiana, okay. Sorry about that, Tiana. That's how it's pronounced, right? Tiana Cordero? Okay, I'm looking at the chat. Okay, Tiana. I mispronounced. My name is Serge Gabin is there. I said hi to you. You just came on camera now. Roxanne, welcome. How you doing? I hope you're doing okay. All right, so... I was saying, I hope everybody's keeping safe and I hope the community is growing stronger, you know. So today we'll be talking about, and I know you guys have had a lot of great speakers. I'm a great presenter. I'm very humbled to be here today. I'm thankful for Jason that believes in me all the time and feels like I'm ready to be in front of you guys, to inspire you and give you some word of wisdom. Thank you so much, Jason, for every opportunity you gave me. I am very, very honored. So it's always a privilege, right? Because I was once in that place. Jason, can you please change the screen and put back everybody on the screen? It's a little bit distracting for me. I love to see like the whole family together. Now I'm just seeing myself and I can't really. Can you change back the screen and put everybody on the screen for me, please? Thank you. I like to make connection when I'm talking to people so that we can make this a Can you put back everybody on the screen for me, please? Jason?
I think I did. You can't see everybody?
No, I can't.
Let's see.
All right, I got you. Thank you. Thank you so much.
You're
so this is way better, right? Because it's not about me yet. It's about all of us. All right. I want us to get that from the get-go. It's not about me. I'm just a vessel that's going to be with you guys for a couple of moments to give you guide work, give you just share my story. And what's funny, Brian? Yeah, it's not about me, all right? Don't make this about me, please. Make it about the knowledge that we're going to get. Make it about the experience that we're going to exchange. Make it about looking at yourself as part of the solution, not part of the problem. Because we'll be talking about solutions, right? We'll be talking about how to look at ourselves as young aspiring leaders, right? If you are where you are today, it's because you are a young aspiring leader. So I want you to look at yourself like that. That's why I don't want it to just be me on the screen talking. I want all of us to share this moment together, all right? So we just have Yamira that jumped in. Welcome, Yamira. How are you doing today? Rokaya Diaby, or Rokia, welcome. all right, so we're going to start. The session is called Inspired to Lead with a D. Why inspired to lead? Inspired to lead because I was once in your place, right? And I got inspired by someone else to be a leader. You know, so now I created this session that I do all over the place called Inspired to Lead. On this chat, I'm so proud because I have a couple of people that are on my private chat and we meet every 2 days and we have a great family meeting. It's just an awesome feeling, right? I have Stefan, I have Muiz, I have Luz, and I have Alisa that's on the phone on the other side. So this is a lifestyle, right? This is not me trying to be somebody that I'm not. Leadership is my lifestyle, right? Inspiration is what I breathe and I live. Because without leadership and inspiration, there cannot be a tomorrow. There cannot be a leaders of tomorrow. We always have to want to look back, you know, and share what we get on a daily basis, right? So my title for today, for those that are visual like me, if you want to take note or write, the title for today's presentation is Pressure Makes Diamond. Pressure makes diamond. And I'm going to break it down. Welcome, Mohammed Bey. How are you doing? Isabel, welcome. Who am I missing? Kelvin Penida, welcome. So pressure makes diamonds, right? What does that mean? Can I have two people volunteer to tell me what comes to their mind when they hear precious makes diamond? And be very brief so that everybody could have the ability to speak. I don't want to choose. If you want, just show me, raise your hand. Let's go with it. Roxanne, you want to go? I didn't want to choose, but I have to do it. Let's go, Roxanne. Tell me what comes to your mind when you hear pressure makes diamonds? Someone put Roxanne's mic on so that she can speak. Your mic is on, I think, Roxanne. Yes, mic is on. You can go.
Okay, so hi, everyone. Mm-hmm. So Hello. When I hear pressure makes diamond, like you need to make some effort to have a diamond, right? It requires some effort. That's what's coming in my mind when I hear that.
It means you need to make effort to have diamond. Okay, that's not bad. That's not bad. I'll take that. Tiana, You want to tell me what comes to your mind when you hear pressure makes diamonds?
Just like effort, basically. Having to put in the work. Like, it's not made overnight. It's not made very quickly, but it's a process that takes time. Over time, you will have a diamond. So the work that you put in will be worth the end result. And how big your diamond will be.
Mm-hmm.
In a lot of work, you can have a really big, massive diamond, or you could have a rare diamond, a pink diamond. But if you put in very little work, your diamond will be small. You'll have something to show. It just won't be that big.
Thank you. I'll choose Brian Carter last. Oh, I saw Moise's hands up. Brian, then Moise, and that's it. Brian, tell me what comes to your mind when you hear that.
Well, basically, like everyone is saying, basically you have to apply yourself. Like you have to put forth some effort to achieve your goal in life, period. So that's what that comes with that saying, basically. Like what doesn't kill you, we're only going to make you stronger.
I love that. I love that. Thank you, Brian. Moise, you last.
My interpretation is quite similar, but I feel like pressure makes diamond. Like if we look at it literally, when miners look for diamond, they have to add lots of pressure and a lot of hard work before they get diamond. So pardon me if this is a little bit touche or cheesy. If we apply this on ourselves, it's like when we are put under immense pressure, we could discover our true potential. We could be that diamond when put under immense pressure, and we had essentially we being the diamond under pressure. That's how
I like that. Thank you. I like every answer that you guys gave. And it came together, right? It came together. Welcome, Judy Hampton. Olahun Mia Jibola, welcome. And somebody else is connecting. I'll call everybody by name, right? That's just me. So Isabel, welcome. So precious make diamond, right? What does that have to do with leadership? What does that have to do with you being a better person? You know, but everyone that spoke, right? Tiana, Brian, you know, everyone that spoke said something that had to do with the process, right? I want you guys to stay with me, please. Everyone said something that had to do with the process. You know, we spoke about time. We spoke about effort. We spoke about the pressure. You know, some people didn't speak about the outcome, but the process always have something called the outcome, because when you have a calling, you have a time, you have your purpose, right? And then in all that process, you have to look about, what do I become, right? Because if you don't look at what do I become, it becomes difficult for you to assess what your process will be. Because if you're just sitting down and say, oh, I just want to be successful. So what? You want to be successful in what? Right? Welcome, Extel Gambi. How you doing? Okay. So what do you want to be successful in? What do you want to do? What do you want to become? Right? What do you want to come out with after the confinement, after the quarantine? All right? So pressure makes diamond is something that it came to my mind a couple of weeks ago, and I spoke about it on my different group chat that I have. But I didn't go in depth in it. I know Moise and Stefan are looking at me funny, like, would he never cover this? Yes, because that's something I was still processing in my mind, right, before bringing it out there. And when I thought of this opportunity to be here with you, awesome leaders, I was like, why not bring it to the awesome leaders so that we could talk about it together? Cyril Njiken, for those that don't know me, I'm originally from Cameroon. I migrated from Douala. Estelle is my sister, right? I see her dancing. I migrated from Douala 12 years ago, and with $120 in my pocket. That was all I had, right? It was a lot at the time. With a dream, $120 and a dream. the dream that every young African that migrate from Africa to the West is becoming successful, right? Because being in Cameroon, I'd done everything I could do. I was a high school dropout. I went into a vocational school to learn computer engineering. I learned some computer engineering, and then I worked for 6 years back home in Yaoundé. And then I did what all my peers did. I started looking for ways to go, right? I almost traveled through the Sahara, but I didn't have the heart to do it. You know, I was a chicken at the time, not like now. But I started looking for visa in different embassies. I got refused visa in 6 embassies. And finally, the last embassy was the American embassy. I got a 6-month visa, and that was it. I said I wasn't going back. 12 years ago, travel, came in here, overstayed my visa, become undocumented, did every minute job you could imagine on the face of the earth, from a 99-cent store security to gas station attendant to bathroom attendant in a nightclub, you know, to everything. Imagine yourself, every job you think out there, I did, you know, for undocumented people. And while I was in that process, I was under the pressure, right? Remember the title, right? Pressure makes diamonds. So I was under the pressure because I didn't forget what made me take that step to come to America, you know? I almost gave up a lot of time because I was like, this is so tough, man. Nobody told me when I was in Africa that moving to America would be this tough. Nobody told me that I'm going to come and I'll have to pay bills. Nobody told me I'll have to work. I'll have to work 7 days a week from 7 to 7 to get $300 a week, you know? Nobody told me these things. I just got thrown out in the lion's den. And I started finding my way, right? Got kicked out of a couple of apartments, you know? And that's a regular story. My story is not that different. The only difference about my story is that I held on to my dream. I held on to the goal, right? And then I started figuring out during that period of being undocumented, what process is going to take me to achieve my American dream, right? What process, right? Everybody comes in, most of us are undocumented, and we take different process, right? But mine was, I was asking myself, what am I going to do? You know, I'm in the Bronx, I'm working hard. What is it going to take for me to get my American dream? And one day at the gas station I was working, I found out a flyer that says, take a GED and, you know, something about you achieving your dream while taking a GED or something, going back to school. And I kept the flyer in my back pocket, and that was it. You know, a couple of months later, I got my my working permit and my green card. And the first thing that I did was decided to go back to school to get my education. I remember earlier on, I told you guys I was a high school dropout, so I didn't have any official high school diploma from Africa. So I had to go back and get my GED as an adult learner. Registered to Westchester Community College. 2 years later, I got my associate, moved to Lehman, transferred at Lehman College. 2 years, got my bachelor's and in TV production, and then went to City College for my master's degrees in film. So, and I'm going fast because of time constraint, but a lot of things changed in this process, right? Because when I was at Lehman, I took a leadership class that you guys are taking now with Jason. I took that leadership class with Suzette, and my whole life changed. That's when people started showing me that I had something in me. People started showing me that they could believe in me, just the same way Jason is inviting me to speak. Suzette told me I had something in me and that I could use it. You know, she told me I was a good speaker. She told me I was presenting very well, and she put me in a position to use those abilities. So 2 years later, I graduated from Lehman, went to City College with my master's. And at Lehman, I ran for SGA president. So I was the SGA president at Lehman College. I was the SGA president at City College during my grad. And the official job I'm doing now at CUNY is executive director for the University Student Senate, for those that know what that is. How will I get a master's degree in film, an MFA in film, and become the executive director for the University Student Senate is just the fact that I was good at what I did as an SGA president, and I was very, very, you know, diligent with my job as a student leader. So when the position opened, for the executive director, they didn't think twice before giving me the job. And now I'm doing my PhD in organizational leadership at the North Central University in Arizona. All right, I'm a filmmaker, independent filmmaker. I'm a public speaker. I'm a motivational speaker. I'm a life coach. I'm a whatever you want to, any title you're going to give him, an actor. I'm on Netflix. If you want to go and Google my name, that's good for you. But all that doesn't count if I don't do this. If I don't come back and speak to you guys, it doesn't count for me. All right? So that would just be titles upon titles. What will make me great is if you guys get inspired after the 2 hours we spent today, someone could dream better and bigger. Because my grandfather always told me, if your dream doesn't make you scared, it means you're not dreaming yet. So if you can't dream as big as I dream, it means you're not dreaming yet. You have a long way to go, all right? So we establish all the foundation. That's me. Don't focus on Googling me now. Let's wait when this is done, then you're going to Google me to see what I did, all right? Let's focus on the talking because I know some people are already moving around. So pressure makes diamonds. I am a diamond. I'm gold, I'm silver, I'm emerald, I'm everything, right? That's just me because I self-validate. I'm not arrogant, but I self-validate a lot. You know why I self-validate a lot? Because I don't expect people to validate me. If you expect people to validate you, you're going to be disappointed because people are not going to give you the same validation that you give yourself. All right. So when I say I'm a diamond, I'm an emerald, I'm gold, this is not me being cocky. This is just me being self-validating, you know. So, and that put me in a safe space, right? Because if none of you say that to me, I'm still cool with you guys. I still love you guys, right? So I am a diamond and I came through pressure, right? Good job, Yanira. You're doing great with your hair. I love that. it's okay. Take your time. Don't stop. I didn't say she's stop. That's a way for you to focus. I understand. I know you're listening. I just wanted to break the ice with that. But I'm a diamond, right? And I came through pressure. I am where I am right now because of pressure. And I'm not here because I'm perfect. I am here because I could withstand the pressure. All right? And if I did it, guess what? You guys and you ladies can do it. All right? So my journey is not different from your journey, Brian. My journey is not different from Sarah's journey. My journey is not different from Estelle's journey. We have the same journey, but we have to have the same courage. So my message for you today is pressure makes diamonds. Why? Because we're going to go through the pressure, but we have to withstand that pressure and that heat to become that diamond that we want to become. All right? So what do you have to do in between the time that you discover yourself to put yourself where you are right now and to look at the end of that process, which is the outcome of who you're going to become, right? Because if you don't know what you're going to become when the process is over, I have news for you. Your process is not right. That's why there is something called strategy. You have to create a strategy so that by the end of the day, you know what you're going to become in the next 5, 6 years, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 years. All right. Don't just give yourself vague hope and vague a lot of things. Be very specific in your process. All right. So there's something that I call calling, time, and purpose. CTP. That's mine, right? CTP is something that I created at Lehman because I was like, who am I? Why am I here? You know, I came here from Westchester Community College. I knew nothing about student leadership. And I moved to Lehman and I saw something called the student life. I walked in that building and my life changed. Why am I here? Is it a coincidence? You know, and I'm not the type of person to believe in coincidence, right? I believe in divine appointment because we are where we are because of a reason. Right, Marita? If you're here today, it's for a reason. You're not here by mistake. Right? You're not here to take away Jason's time and run with it. You're here because Jason has some knowledge to instill in you so that you become a better person. Right? Jason is not here by mistake. He's here because his calling is a calling of giving. You guys notice that, right? He has a family, but he's there giving, always giving, always giving. That's what everybody, every one of us on this chat is here for a reason. So now you have to ask yourself, why am I here? What's my calling? The moment you answer that question, what's my calling? You are going to understand the process and you're going to understand the outcome. All right? So you have to ask yourself what's your calling. First question, who can show of hand, who knows their calling on the group chat right now? Who knows what their calling is? Estelle, hands is up. Welcome, Nuha. How you doing? Okay, so I have one person, two people. Who else? Three people, Brian, Steph, that's four. That's great. Mohammed knows his calling. Luz knows his calling. That's great. If you guys know your calling already, that's awesome. Because your calling is going to guide you through your purpose. Remember, calling, time, purpose. Your calling is going to drive you through your purpose. So, Isaac, you know your call. Isaac is on the call? Wow, surprising. Welcome, Isaac. Everybody knows their calling. That's great. Okay, that's cool. Everybody knows their calling. Okay, I'm excited. So we're one step ahead, right? So if you know your calling is going to drive you through your purpose. You know, because your purpose is what you were made to achieve. If you can't know your calling, your journey is going to be twice longer. And I'm going to explain myself on that. It's easy for somebody that know that, you know what? Being a cop is something that drives me crazy. Like I want to be a cop so bad. And not me, I'm talking about someone. I want to be a cop so bad. I'm ready to do everything to join the police force. You're not going to go and study nursing, right? You're going to go and study criminal justice. You're going to put yourself in the path of becoming a cop. Are we making sense? So the moment you know you understand your calling, welcome, Missy Feliz. The moment you understand your calling, it's going to guide you through your purpose, because now the decisions that you're going to make are going to be easy decisions that will take you through your purpose. All right. So if you know that nursing is something that you love a lot, and then you decide not to study nursing and go and study something else, it means that you're taking yourself out of that journey through your purpose. Because at the end of the day, you want to look back and say, wow, I'm so happy. I'm just the happiest nurse. Like now, right? What is happening out there now? The first responder, if you were a first responder and you're not doing it because it's your calling, you're going to be a miserable first responder. You're going to be like covering your face, your eye, your head, everywhere in your body, because you don't even want to touch anyone, right? But if you're doing this, we've seen a lot of nurses out there that are doing this out of love. They're ready to put their life on the line to save people. That's calling right there, right? So calling is very, very important. It's very important to know your calling. Your calling is going to guide you through your purpose. At the end of your day, I have a friend. Should I call her a friend or an acquaintance? I would say an acquaintance, but we're getting close. She's a nurse. But she's the most miserable nurse I've ever seen in my life. All right? She did nursing for the money. She's making $38, $39 an hour. And she tells me, she says, Cyril, I'm just doing this for my children, like giving them the best house and everything. She's real, you know? And that's why I love her, because she is real. She said, I never liked nursing in my life. I did it because when I was going to college, they told me that they paid her more than $30 an hour, and I jumped in it. And you could see in her that she's not called to be a nurse. And she says it. She does her job not with any ounce of compassion and empathy. You don't want to be that person. You don't want to be the most miserable professional in your life that you woke up in the morning and say, oh, again, I'm going to work. You want to be that person that wakes up in the morning and that want to go, and it's not a job. It's your calling. You just want to do it, like me. Waking up in the morning, going to USS office is like, oh my gosh. You know, I'm miserable now. I still work from home, but I'm miserable because I miss the students that I serve all the time, right? I always want to be there for the student. I want to, you know, try to take time out to tell them how they could be better. You know, me being on a set of a movie is like a baby in a toy store. Like, I don't want it to stop. You know, that's my calling. You know, and I combine both of my calling, education and filmmaking together. right? So I know who I am. I know what my calling is. And I know what my purpose is. And I know that knowing my calling is driving me towards my purpose because I'm not distracted. I'm on that path going straight towards my purpose. And I know at the end of the day, when I look back, I'm going to be proud of my journey. I'm going to be proud of myself as a leader because I was like, I did everything I loved. I did everything I wanted to do, you know? So that's about calling. It's very, very important. It's very important to know your calling. The time, right? Pressure. Brian spoke about time. Tiana spoke about time and spoke about the effort. In between the calling and the purpose, there's that time and there's that effort that you have to put to be that better person. You have to put to be that better leader. And that is what is seminars, is Zoom meetings like this, is being part of the Leadership Academy, right? It's being part of the SGA, it's being part of a club, it's creating your own club, right? Is thinking about every idea that you can put in place to make your life and the life of the rest of the people better. Time and effort. In the summer, I started cleaning the street in my community. I live in the Bronx, so I will go to take the train to work, and I will notice that there's dirt on the floor. And one day I took my son. You know, I used to ignore it. I just have to be real. I used to ignore the dirt on the floor. I would just walk in the train and that's good. But one day I took my son and walk on that path and he saw the dirt on the floor and he looked at me like, Daddy, why is there so much dirt on the floor? And I was ashamed. I was like, wow. I didn't know what to say, right? And then the next day I took him out and we bought gloves, mask, and we went out and we started cleaning. And I did a short video and I put that video on Twitter. And we had 22,000 views in 2 days. And I got a call from the mayor's office. I got a call from the city council. I got a call from all the Bronx people. Finally, somebody understood that they needed to clean that place, right? So when you're walking in your calling, you're going to do things that you think is mistake, but it was just called for at that time for you to do it, for a change to happen, right? If I didn't take my children and go and clean that street would still be dirty up till today. But because of what we did that day in June, that was June or July 5th, they're still cleaning that place every week today. All right. So it's action, it's time, it's effort, it's putting time and effort into you becoming somebody better. Did I clean the street because I needed any accolade from somebody? No, I cleaned the street because I wanted a cleaner community. I cleaned the street because I wanted to show my son that do not expect nobody to do it for you, do it for yourself. All right. And I'm sure he learned the lesson. 8 years old. Bet you his life is never going to be the same. Because now he got interviews from New York One, News 12, CBS, CNN, everybody. So that stuck in his mind for 8 years old. He was like, Daddy, do I need to be on TV? Do I need to clean the street to be on TV? I'm like, you don't need to clean the street to be on TV, but if you do what is right, right things is going to happen to you. You know? So that's the message. You have to put yourself in your calling and put the right effort around you. Surround yourself with the right people for the right purpose to open itself to you. Because some people say, and I say that a lot, when you find your calling and you walk through that time and through that calling, the stars are going to align. Like, you trust me, we go to Albany with a lot of students. Some students get internship just because they met an elected official and spoke to them for 2 seconds, all right? If you stayed on campus and you were just a student that went in and out of school, you're never going to have that opportunity to speak to an elected official. Never. So you found your calling, it's advocacy. You join the SGA, you join the club, you join Malawi, you join all these great things. You travel to Albany to advocate for the 500,000 students, and then you meet elected official, and now you're face to face with the people that you see on TV all the time, and you jump on the opportunity to introduce yourself and speak, and then before you know, you have an opportunity. So I don't know if you guys have seen the process. Are you guys seeing the process? You have to be able to understand who you are as a leader or as an aspiring leader to be able to put yourself in those environments that are going to make you grow as a person and grow as a leader. This is nothing that's going to happen by mistake. And this is nothing that's going to just be, oh, you know what? I'm just going to class and then I'm going home. Man, I don't do that student government thing. It doesn't give me nothing. Good for you if you're that person. I know you're not that person because you're here right now, but you have to put yourself in that position of success, all right? we know a lot of our students that came. We have Saint, we have Adrian. Well, most of them spoke to you already. We have a lot of these students that came through the places that you are right now, and now they're great leaders because of this position. All right? They're great students because of this position. You know, and all of them are coming back to give back because they believe that their life changed because of people like Jason, because of people like Suzette, because of people like all these people that are surrounding us and instilling in us. That's why we're here. That's why I'm here right now, because I believe that my life changed because of a Leadership Academy class. All right? So now, pressure is always going to be there. Pressure is always going to be there. But if you don't look at yourself like a very entitled American that all of us are, you're not going to give up. Right? Because entitlement is what entitlement and just believing that everything's supposed to be given to you is one of the things that are going to make you feel like, oh, I don't need to put much effort. Why am I even struggling? You know? Why am I struggling? I don't need to, why am I even doing this? You know, but if you look at it with purpose, if you tell yourself, Cyril, you flew 6,000 miles away from Douala to be in New York, it wasn't by mistake. It's because you have to succeed so that you can go back over there and help somebody's life become better. You're never going to be the same person. All right? If you think your ancestors moved from wherever they moved, because this is a very diverse group of people, right? Wherever you came from, Dominican Republic, Puerto Rico, Colombia, everywhere, Mexico, wherever you came from, and you came to New York to get this opportunity, and you think it's just for your good looks, for you to become the best American person and wearing great jacket and beautiful sneakers, something is wrong with you. Because you have to be the avenue for other people to be blessed. The blessing is not supposed to stop on you. If you think the blessing is going to stop on you, you are in the wrong place. You are in the wrong place. That's not what leadership is. Leadership is about serving. It's about serving. It's about being a servant. It's about being there for others, for other people to be better. You know? It's about being there for other people to be better. So you have to look at it like, okay, why am I here? Okay, I understand why I'm here. Now I'm going to create an avenue for other people to receive the blessing. It doesn't matter your situation. It does not matter your situation. Most people focus on the situation. They focus on the now and they don't focus on it. I always say, trust me, write it down for people that are writing. Enjoy the journey while focusing on the goal. Enjoy your journey while focusing on the goal. Your goal is what? Is achieving your purpose. Your goal is becoming the magistrate. Your goal is becoming the judge. Your goal is becoming the president of Nigeria. Your goal is becoming the most successful, the ambassador of Cameroon, right? Your goal is becoming whatever you want to become in here. The nurse, the police commissioner, becoming whatever. But at the end of the day, if that goal is for selfish gain, good for you. Right? Would have lost one. But if that goal is for us to grow this family and make it even better, guess what? The sky is not the limit. The sky is not the limit. I know some of you guys are surprised, right? The sky is not the limit. I could tell you that right now. Because a lot of people say the sky is the limit. They're lying. Tell them they're lying. Right? Raziel, Happy New Year. Oh my God, Raziel is here. My brother. I miss you, man.
Yeah, same here, man. Nice to meet everyone. Nice to see everybody again. It's been a while.
Yes, it is. It is. It is. Thank you. Thank you for showing up. So the sky is not the limit, right? Because what you see up there is a cloud. I travel a lot by plane. And when I flew, when the plane take off, after 12,000 miles, we're on top of the cloud. And I always look up. I don't see nothing. And guess what? The people that go in the sky with the rocket ship, they see other things over there. So there's no limit. The limit is in your mind. Right? The limit is in your mind. So do not limit yourself. Do not waste the resources. All the things that we're doing now, you guys are on the Zoom chat right now, listening to a motivational speaker, is the resources that the office of the Leadership Academy is giving you. That's the resources that Jason is giving you guys for you to empower yourself. This is not just because we have so much time in our hand now. No. You know, it's because you need those resources to grow. All right? Read books. Right? Read books. I'm reading this right now. Jason, do you still have these books with you? Okay, if you don't have it, I'm going to forward you the title, but it's very cheap. You can have it. It's called Leadership for a Better World. I finished it already, but I'm reading it over and over again because there's still good stuff to learn from it. That's a book I read in my second year of leadership class at Lima. You know? So read books, put yourself in a position of growth, because finding your calling is not the end of the road. Finding your calling is the beginning of the road, right? So now when you find your calling, you have to understand that you have those great dreams. And those great dreams, the bigger the dreams, the bigger the pressure. Right? Like somebody said, the money, the more money, the more problem. The bigger, I'm going to put the author's name in the chat in a few, right? Estelle, just give me 1 minute. The bigger the dream, the bigger the problem. Because there's something out there called the dream killers. You know, you may not see them as dream killers, but there's that person beside you that always tell you, oh, you, that's too much, man. You can't do it. Why are you dreaming so hard? When I decided to go back to school, most of my friends told me, why are you going to school, man? We came to America to make that money. And all of them are cab drivers. I have nothing against cab drivers, right? But 6 years later, now they cannot even tell me face to face congratulations. They come in my inbox to tell me congratulations, you know, for all the achievement that I've had. So your reality is not my reality. Look at the hands, bro. These fingers are not the same. It's for a reason. You know, it's not because you came, right, Mustafa? I'm lying. It's for a reason, right? So if you came here, yes, if you came here to be a cab driver, good for you. I didn't come here to be a cab driver. I came here to be the biggest thing that could ever happen to America, right? So it's your reality, and I respect you for going through that. But do not convince me that my reality is wrong. Do not do that. So you have a lot of those people around you that will tell you that, no, why are you doing that? Don't do that. School doesn't give nothing. Oh, you're taking the student loans for nothing. Guess what? I'm taking the student loans, and I'm going to get that PhD, and I'm going to pay them off in 1 year. Because when I'm done with my PhD, my yearly salary is going to be enough for me to pay that student loan. All right? So do not tell me that I'm taking the student loans for nothing. All right? So it's not about you. You're not the one taking the loans. I'm the one taking the loans. So why? What? Mind your business, man. You have to get to the point where you tell people to mind their business, because people come to kill your dreams. We're talking about pressure making diamonds, right? People come to kill your dream. People call you from back home. Oh, well, you know, you're not sitting in any Western Union. This person went yesterday and they already built a house for their parents. It doesn't matter. It does not matter, right? My calling wasn't to build a house for my parents at this age. When I get to the place, I'm going to build a house for my parents. All right. So, and I'm just being real. These are real stories that we're going through. Yanira, I wish I had a beautiful background like that, man. You guys are just driving me crazy with those beautiful backgrounds. Jesus Christ, history. Hostos visionary. I like that. And I know I have a hostos. Everybody have a beautiful background. I'll create my own background. It's okay. So you have to be, it's pressure. Pressure comes from everywhere. You know, pressure comes from your peers. Pressure comes from family. Because not everybody have the same journey. Remember, some family members didn't have the chance to educate themselves. So they see your education as a waste of time. Right? They see your education as a waste of time. They see your education like, why is she wasting too much time? She should be working or getting married or something. Or he should be working or doing something and taking care of the family. So you have to be able to block those things. Stay focused. Put your binders and tell yourself, please, I'm going to achieve my goal. My goal is my goal. And guess what? I'm going to inspire other people to achieve their goal. You know, my greatest push for me to be the best person ever is my children. I have twins, girls, 5 years old, and a boy, 8 years old. And when I look at them, I want to surpass myself, because I grew up without a father. You know, I was raised without a father. I didn't know him, but he's missing. My father is missing a lot, because even though I was a bad kid, but I was a cool kid, man. So it's missing. So, but now raising these kids here make me look at myself through their eyes and just have fun. I don't know if you guys got that, but it's so complicated. you know, but just raising them make me look at myself through their eyes and just enjoying every second of it. Because they're cool children, right? I always want to show them that I'm a superhero. I want to show them that I could achieve everything. So, yo, son, you're 8 years old. Guess what? Your dad is getting a PhD at age 40. You get a PhD at age 24. And I'm not pushing you to do what you don't want to do, but guess what? You have to challenge me. If I did it with raising you guys as a family, having a full-time job, being a full-time filmmaker, full-time everything, guess what? You can do better than me. You know? So you have to hold on to something to motivate yourself to keep pushing. It could be your story. It could be just, you know, and I could even push it higher for people like us that grew up with a single mother and where every family member judged every step and every action that we did and call us names. That's my motivation. When I think of all the names, negative names I was called, I want to erase that by being the best person ever. All right? I want to erase all that by being the best person. I don't want to hold on to that and cry and be stressed and be depressed. No, that is my mark. That is the goal that I'm going to achieve, that goal, so that I could look at these people and say, in your face, you said I would never make it, right? Guess what? I actually made it. So what are you holding on to be a better person, to be a better leader? What are you holding on to? What's your anti-depression? What's your anti-depressive? What takes you out of that pressure when you're almost getting like, oh my God, I can't do this anymore? What's your strength? What do you hold on to? You have to be able to define that, because those are the things that are going to help you through your journey. You know, I'm not going to come and give you theories and all those big quotes. I'm not into that. I like to be real, down to earth. You know, I could have done that. I could have broken a whole PowerPoint here. But at this point, we're in a pressure time, and people need to know that time is the most expensive commodity that we have. So if you don't lose it, you use it. If you don't use it, you lose it. If you don't use it, you lose it. All right? So now is the time for you guys to look at yourself like, okay, I was called in here for a reason, and I'm going to make sure that I take advantage of that reason, and I'm going to be the best version of myself. You're not competing with nobody. Estelle, you're not competing with nobody. Yanira, you're not competing with nobody. Mustafa, you're not competing with nobody. You're competing with yourself. You're competing with yourself. Right, Sakina? You're competing with yourself, right? You're not competing with nobody. Tiana, you're not competing with nobody. Brian, you're not competing with nobody. You're competing with yourself. Your only competition should be who? Yourself. When you wake up in the morning, look at yourself in the mirror and say, I'm the shit. I'm going to make it. My competition will never be Jason. Jason knows how much he inspires me. He knows that. I'm always in his Facebook, liking his picture, commenting, encouraging, loving his family and everything. Why? Because I look up to him, and vice versa. All right? Because I know that if I'm somewhere tomorrow, I know that I'm have a place where I can go and call home. That's Hostos Leadership Academy. It doesn't matter. I walk there anytime, any day. I know that it's my home. Why? Because Jason and I have that kindred spirit. We have that bond that we created from the first day we met. He supported all the initiative that we always brought to him, you know, with Hostos SG. That's why I love and appreciate him as a person, you know. I know he's very humble. He doesn't like when I speak like this about him, but I don't give a shit. I just love him, all right? He's just humble. I know him. He's going to look at me like, oh, it's okay. No, it's not okay. We have to appreciate people when they're there. We don't have to wait behind their back to start, you know. So it's very important that we set that mark. It's very important that we create a strategy. Who here has a vision board? Estelle, la sonnelle a coupé la lumière. Your light went off.
What happened? I've been in class like the whole day. So the light bulb got so hot, so I'm like, okay. And I have a class at 6:20.
Did you hear what I said? I said, Sunel took your light away. That's what we do back home when the light goes off. Sometimes we stay 24 hours to 48 hours without light. But people don't know what I'm talking about.
There.
Who here has a vision board? Tiana, can you repeat that, please? Who here has a vision board? How many people have a vision board? Serge, you have a vision board? Do you? Can you show me your hand if you have a vision board, Serge? Do you? You have a vision board, right? Okay. So 1, 2, 3, 4. We have a lot of people. Oh, Kabira, you have a vision board. Tiana, you have a vision board? No, you don't? All right. Why am I talking about vision board? A vision board is going to help you create this process that we're talking about, right? You could have a small vision, it depends on everybody. Everybody, some people are artistic, they create some. For people that have been in my office, you know what I'm talking about, right? I have a vision board in my office. It's like on the right. You cannot miss it. You know, you cannot miss it. Oh, I actually signed up for a Zoom session tomorrow with CCSD to make one. Awesome. Awesome, Tiana. Proud of you. Proud of you. Trust me. You're going to love it. You're going to love it. It's going to give you, I don't have a vision board, but I have a planner. Yes. Yes. Yeah, that's a vision. The difference between a vision board is a planner. People are different. Remember, people are different, right? You have a planner, so you write a lot, right? It's like, right, Sakina? It's like a journal. Is it a planner, or is it a journal? It's a planner, right, with date and everything? Okay, so the difference with that and the vision board is that for people that are visual, like us, it's there, I see it, right? It's pictures. Now my vision board have 4 pictures. I have a picture of me speaking in front of 30,000 people, because that's a dream that I have. Right, Stefan? You've seen my vision board, right, Stefan? Okay. Me speaking. You want to say what? Do you remember what I have on my vision board, Stefan?
You're putting me on the spot today.
I have to put you on the spot. Do you remember?
So I believe it's a house. It's your also speaking in front of 30,000 people. So that's definitely on there. I just forgot the last two, but I remember your vision board. But then you told me to make my own. So if you asked me about my own.
So my vision board is me speaking in front of 30,000 people. It's me graduating with my PhD, my doctorate. And it's me, my favorite house, beautiful, beautiful house that I will be giving to my children a little bit in a couple of, I would say soon, pretty soon. And what's the last thing on my vision board? My foundation, my orphanage. My dream is to build an orphanage in Africa that will be hosting 150 children, orphans. That will be a home that will be called My Sister Cares Foundation Orphanage. And all these things that I have on my vision board, I'm already working on them. It's not something that I'm putting in there for tomorrow. No, all these things, I'm already working on them. So remember, it's a process, right? What makes diamonds? Pressure, right? So that vision board is going to help you put a positive pressure on yourself not to give up. When you look at those pictures on the wall, you'll be like, wow. Some people put family, some people put travel, people put everything. You know, but it's very, very important that you put it there. As I say, it's in my office where when I sit, it's on the right hand. So anytime I sit, my eye is on there. So there is no way I could miss that. There is no way I could miss that. You know, so I already know that I'm going to speak in front of 30,000 people. I know that because I'm already practicing. How many are we here today? So 10, 15. Yeah, this is cool, right? But 30,000 is what I'm aiming for. And I know it's going to happen. So write this down. Remember I told you guys this. So that when it happened, you say, Cyril told us. Know that I'm going to build that orphanage for those 150 children, because that is like, to me, I'm going to do that. I've already bought the land. And who was there when I was buying the land? Carlos was there when I was buying the land. For those that know Carlos. Right, Jason? Carlos was there. He was there during the groundbreaking. You know, it's on my social media. You guys could see that. You know, so I'm not talking about, oh, maybe it's going to happen. No. There's no maybe. These are things that will happen. These are things that will happen. All right? So, Sakina, do you see the difference between the planner and the vision board, right? Because the vision board is pictures that you put on a board, and you that visually it puts you in a mindset of I'm ready to do this, I'm ready to conquer the world, right? So, that's one thing. That's part of the process. We talk about calling, time, and purpose. Now, how do you digest the pressure? How do you tell yourself, wow, now I have to balance, I have to calm down, don't lose it, don't stress out, don't give up. How do you do that? Because that's something that a lot of leaders struggle with. Mustafa, how do you digest the pressure? When it's tough, how do you do it? Talk to me.
I believe that there's a whole bunch of different ways that you can actually digest the pressure. One of the ways that I like to do is if a lot of things are building up, I feel that, one, praying. Two, going out and exercising. I feel like that's a very, very key important factor. Three, I make lists and I try to separate the goals into smaller goals so I can achieve it little by little. Once you're able to step, you start seeing the bigger picture coming together.
I love that. Thank you, Mustafa. Because guess what? Smaller goals will make bigger goals. Some people focus only on the big goals, but smaller goals will make bigger goals. All right? Smaller goals will make bigger goals. So one thing I tell people that write smaller goals is please write it on something that you're going to read it over and over. Don't just write it on a piece of paper and you forget. I have like four of these on my table right now, you know, because I write a lot. Chad, know that, right? Right, Moise? We're always writing, right? You have to write because it's very important, you know? So you have to write them down, go back to them, because then that's going to give you a pride of, wow, I actually achieved that small goal. It means I can achieve a bigger goal. All right? Tiana, how do you digest your pressure? Praying, meditating. That's true, Mustafa. It's very important. Tiana, yours. The floor is yours.
Am I supposed to type that or just respond verbally?
You can tell me right now. You're already on.
Okay. Sorry, what was the question again?
How do you digest your pressure?
How do I digest pressure?
Yeah, how do you tell yourself it's going to be better?
It always helps when I talk to a friend. Also, I do like an hour of relaxation every day.
Mm-hmm.
So I have like my aromatherapy. I set up my oil diffuser. I have my essential oils going.
Beautiful.
I'll, you know, have like my little Buddha. And also like, in my culture, what the Taínos pray to, our God is the mother God, the Atabex. So mm-hmm. hand in hand with each other. And I'll do like my own spiritual ritual.
Beautiful.
It helps me kind of just saw and just breathe. And
yeah, I like that.
Collect myself.
So you notice that we're talking about, Mustafa spoke about prayer. You spoke about meditation. It's the same thing, right? It's being, going your inner self and just, you know, And I know most people here will have that in their list. Praying, meditating is very important to digest the pressure. But you have to make sure to take that time out to say, you know what? I think I'm getting really stressed now, and I'm going to take this time out to just a me time, right? I'm going to take a me time. Because some leaders think they're saviors, that they're called to save the whole world, you know, and you come out after class, you go and do some volunteering, you come out after the volunteering, you want to help somebody, you want to be there for a friend. No, you're going to burn out. You want to take time out for yourself. It's very, very important. The bigger your goal, the bigger your self-care. Remember, the bigger your goal, the bigger your self-care. If you don't self-care, you're not going to get it to your goal. You're not. Mental health is very important, young leaders. Mental health. I could give you guys a quote till tomorrow, but if I don't talk to you the way I'm talking right now, some of you will not get it. I am where I am because I take care of my mental health. All right? So please, I'm begging you guys, it's important to take care of your mental health. It's very, very, very important. You cannot give what you don't have. You can't give what you don't have. If you're not in a sound state, mental state, what type of student leader are you? What are you going to give the people out there that need you? And the people out there don't care if you don't have it, because all they need from you is get. Who takes care of the stronger ones? I always write that on my social media. I'm the stronger one amidst all the people around me. But nobody calls me and says, Siri, how do you do this morning? Jason, how is the family? How do you feel? Nobody, because people always expect that Jason is the strongest one. He's always going to be there for everybody. All right. So sometimes you want to pause everything and take care of yourself, because only you can take care of yourself. All right. So it's very, very important. I don't want to miss reminding you guys how important mental health is in the process of achieving your purpose. Because achieving your purpose with insanity is not achieving your purpose. You're not going to be able to enjoy yourself or being there for anybody else. All right? So it's very, very important. I like the way Brian said it earlier. What doesn't kill you make you stronger. But guess what? You don't have to even think about, oh, this is going to kill me. The moment you understand that this is tough, take mental health time. All right? Don't tell yourself you're a hero. No. It's better to be a hero that's alive than a dead hero. Right? I know Martin Luther King, but it's okay. It's like one out of a million. It's better to be a hero that's alive than a dead hero. So this is very, very important, guys. We're talking about the process. Now, when you understand what your purpose is, that becomes your focus. We spoke about calling. We spoke about time. We spoke about the effort you put in. Now we're speaking about purpose. When you understand what your purpose is, you have to stay focused to achieve that purpose. You know? So surround yourself with the right people. Tell me who your friend is and I'll tell you who you are. Tiana speaks to friends when she's stressed, right? If her friends are not right friends, she's going to be more stressed when she finishes speaking to them. So she has to surround herself with the right people. She has to surround herself with people that are empathetic, that are compassionate, that are good friends, that will cheer for you when you're winning. All right? You have to share, you have to have friends around you that will cheer when you're winning. Don't have friends that will be jealous. And if you have friends that are more than the hands of this finger, I mean friends, because I know some of you have like 16,000 best friends. If it's more than five, you have a problem. Estelle, you're laughing, right? It means you have like 19 friends, right? So if you have more than five best friends, you have a problem, because guess what? Who do you trust with your issues? You know? Who is a distraction among those people? Because some friends are not going to be there to help you. Now, if all your friends are not in the same mindset as you, you have a problem. Because you are in a mindset of growth and achieving your purpose, but your friends are in a mindset of distraction, you guys will collide. Right, Brian? You guys will be knocking heads because they want to go to the club and they want to go and take a puff, but you want to go and do your homework and you want to go and sit down and do your classes, but they don't understand that. So there will be a clash. You'll be like, oh, since you started going to school, you think you're all that, right? Those type of things. And I know some of you have heard that. So you want to choose your friends wisely. It's very important to be in the mindset of a winner and a leader and a better person, that you surround yourself with like-minded people. People that want to be something in the future. People that want to achieve something in the future. You know, and I do those couple of minute videos that I post on my page. I have one about friendship, and I said it. You know, you have to have enough friends that you can control your circle. And know that if I call this person even at 1 a.m., I'm sure they can be there for me. Because we are in the right mind. We are in the same mindset. It's very important. It's very important. You know, it's very, very important, guys. These are things that we take for granted, but at the end of the day, it holds you back in your journey. It makes you not go as fast as you needed to go to achieve that purpose. It's very, very important. You know, so rethink now. For those that have a lot of friends, rethink, categorize them. Who is your acquaintance? Sorry, who is your colleague? Who is your classmate? Who is your whatever, right? Business partner. And who is your best friend? You have to categorize that. You have to put that. This is, and it's a very, very hurtful process, because like Stefan, I had a lot of friends before, you know, and I had to go through that process. I had to look into my circle and say, who is truly there for me when I need them? You know, who is there to help me grow? Who can hold me accountable? Because you have some friends that are just there for yes, 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 right? They cannot tell you, yo, Serge, what you're doing is not good, man. You're not going to grow if you do that. They cannot tell you, Mustafa, like, why did you do that? Like, we had homework to do and you went somewhere else. You know, so you have to have friends that are accountable and that you can hold accountable. All of you guys can hold each other accountable. All right. So it's very, very important. This is part of the process. Some people became great just because they surrounded themselves with great people. All right. So this is part of the process. You're not living in a bubble. We're living in a community. And sometimes we connect ourselves with people that distract us from our purpose. It's very important to know that. We surround ourselves with people that distract us from our purpose. All right? So now, the most important part. How much time do you put in thinking about your purpose on a daily basis? Is it something that you just think about, like, oh, it's okay, we'll be all right. I'm going to succeed. Or I'm going to go to school and graduate and that's it. Or what do I do to get the best job that I want to get after graduation? Do I wait till I graduate or do I start looking at now so that by the time I graduate, I'm already connected in that job circle? I want to be a community person. I want to be an elected official. Do I wait until I finish school or do I do it now? I'll say 24/7. Awesome. Awesome answer. Always, Mustafa. No, always. 24/7. Yes, I like that. Frequently. Mohammed, frequently, I don't know what you have to explain me what frequently mean. Because frequently for me can mean once every 3 months. That's frequently, right? We have a lot of scholars here. What does frequently mean? Like once every 3 months, every 2 months, right? Help me, guys. What does frequently mean? All the time. Stefan, what does all the time mean?
Because I've been going into like a lot of deep thinking, it's all the time, it's pretty much every day. I think that you should be thinking about your purpose every day. You should be thinking about your goals every day. I think when you mentioned vision board, you look at that every day and it makes you think, what are the steps that I need to take every single day to get closer to those goals? Because those are not the only goals in your life. Those are just the temporary ones because you're going to have goals after those goals. So like Cyril wants to start to 30,000 people. That's not a singular goal. That's like, it's going to be an achievable goal and he's going to achieve things after that. So, I mean, you always have to be living like that. You know what I mean?
Yep. Thank you. You said in a day, I can't focus on one thought 24/7. That's psychology impossible. Good. Yo, he's very intelligent. Thank you, Mohammed. I like that. But guess what? I know it's psychologically impossible or whatever you're saying, but for me, I focus on my goal like in and out of everything I'm doing during the day. I may not be a human, but I do it. Like, psh, trust me, I'm so, like, the people that are in my other chat, I'm already talking to them about us rebuilding a school that I'm working on in Ghana right now. All right? I'm in the middle of coronavirus, but I'm already thinking of that. Like, I have videos, I'm going back and forth with people in Africa. We have to rebuild that school because it has no windows and no doors, no toilet and everything. So, it's not like that's the only thing you're going to be thinking about for your whole life in one day. But that mindset, you put yourself in a mindset where you never forget what is your purpose. You never forget what you have to do to achieve it. All right? What is your main thought in your mind is that, you know? Is in your subconscious, exactly. I work towards my 24/7 and it's talent, it's my subconscious, yeah? So if you know those things already, you know the subconscious, it means that is in the back. It means if I wake you up at 1 a.m. and I ask you, Raziel, what's your purpose? I'm sure you're going to wake up and tell me exactly what was your purpose. Because even in your sleep, somewhere in your mind, you so want to be that person that bad, even in your sleep. I'm not telling you guys something that is magical. I'm telling you, like, it might wake me up at 1 a.m, guys. I'm going to be able to tell you guys how bad I want to be successful. how bad I want to achieve everything I have in my mind. All right? It's not a joke, guys. This is real. This is real, and this is not for you. This is for everybody that you're going to inspire. It's for everybody that the universe has placed under you. Because all of you guys were created, and at that day you were made, we knew God, the universe, Allah, whoever you're calling, knew that today you'll be under Jason's wing. And you'll be learning under his wing. Right? This is not a mistake, guys. I want you guys to take this very seriously. This is real. All right, so the day your calling was given to you, a bunch of people were placed under your wing, and they're just waiting for you to be ready to start giving to them, to start making them dream too, to start making them ready to take over the world. Because if this wasn't important, CUNY will not place it in the campuses. They will not place leadership academies in campuses. They will not place leaders to lead you guys, students, to achieve your goal. If it wasn't necessary, it will not be there. You know, so this is there because it's important and you have to make use of it. So being focused on Michael Jordan was the best. He's the best and will be the best because listen to his interviews. It was about training. It was about putting himself in the mindset of a winner. Einstein, you know, the list goes on and on. Those people will tell you, my mindset was already ready. The moment I found my calling, I knew that's what I wanted to do, and I put myself in that mindset. Never let it go. I never let it go. I always held on to it. Right? So it's very necessary. I'm not going to stop telling you how important it is for you to hold on to your mindset and hold on to your purpose and keep dreaming about it every day, all day. Because the more you visualize it, the more it becomes materialistic, it becomes physical. The more you visualize it, the more physical it becomes. All right? There's no coincidence. It's real. Who said it? You're right. I don't believe in coincidence. Yes, there's no coincidence. Everything is divine appointment. We are here for a reason. That's what I'm saying. If you're going to look at yourself lightly, then it's just going to happen to you like that. Like, I don't think she's ready for it. I don't think he's ready for it. Why do we need to give him? You know? So I can't stress it anymore that how important it is. So then the good part about it, after we focus on those things, is I have good news for you. I have good news for you guys and ladies. It feels so good when you achieve it. It feels so good when you achieve it. It feels like, oh my God. You feel like you were in the beach somewhere in Jamaica, Dominican Republic, just laying on the sand and everything is just beautiful because all the effort that you put in is finally paying off, right? I graduated from City College, and on June 4th, at the graduation day, I stood out there in the quad and I just looked at the whole campus and I played back 2 years of my life. Of going to class, going to SJ, going to USS office, taking my children to school, you know, being a family man, being a student, driving Uber at the same time. And I just felt awesome. I just felt like screaming because I knew I'd achieved something. You know, I was the first person in my family to have a master's degree, a high school dropout, a freaking high school dropout, guys. All right. So, that feeling, I can't explain it with words. It's just awesome. But why is it so awesome? Because I braved all the stress. I braved all the pressure, right? And now the diamond is out. What a beautiful moment, right? I was giving hugs to everybody. It wasn't like today. There was no coronavirus. I was hugging everybody on the quad, just hugging every graduate out there. You know, just because, and they could not get it. They didn't get why I was happier than them. Most people were like, why is he so happy? He's just a master. I was like, no, it's not just a master. It's the effort that I put in getting that. It's the struggles I went through to achieve that. Right? So if you can't look at your effort and value them, if you can't look at your stress and value them, you're never going to value your reward. Never. So it's very, very important, guys, for you to value your journey. It's very important to value the process, because the more you value the process, the more you value yourself, the more you value the people that are here for you, because you guys are here today because people are there for you. You have family supporting you. You have friends supporting you. You have professors supporting you. You have leaders. You have people that are there for you. And if you don't value those, you're not going to be able to value yourself. So me being happy that they're at City College, just being ecstatic, was just looking at that. And guess what question I asked myself that day? I gave $5 to the person that gave me the right answer. What's the question you ask yourself when you achieve that? Oh my God, Mustafa, I owe you $5. Who's Mustafa? Where's Mustafa speaking? Oh, he's here. Mustafa, I owe you $5. You the man. What's next? Okay, I'll give you $250 and I'll give $250 to Nisi, because you guys give it almost at the same time. What's next is the question that you ask yourself. All right? What's next? Thank you, Serge. Thank you for sharing your story. It's very inspiring. Thank you, Serge. Serge is here, right? Yeah. What's next? Serge, you just missed $5 because you're giving me a compliment, man. You're so selfless. You know? What's next, right? So that day I'm standing on the quad at City College. I'm enjoying the moment, but in my mind, that little voice is asking me, okay, Mr. Leader, okay, Mr. Big Shot, what's next? Right? And that's the day I took the decision to go for my doctorate. Right? That's the day I took the decision to go for my doctorate. That's the day. And this is my story. I'm not saying everybody to do that. I'm just saying for me, I was like, okay, if I came to America, right? And as a high school dropout, I went back to school and I got a master. What is stopping me from getting the doctorate? It's just a step ahead, right? And then that's going to be the highest level for me to achieve everything that I wanted to achieve. So that day I took the decision to go for my doctorate. And I took a year off, I relaxed, I breathed, enjoyed myself, and then boom, I started looking for the college to do that. You know? So, Marita Martinez, thank you for sharing your story. If you can succeed in your education, then so can I. Who is she? Where is she? I love this person that just wrote this. Marita, you are awesome. Right? You just realized that. If I did it, guess what? You can do it. And Stefan, what am I doing now? What am I doing right now as we're talking? What am I doing right now? I'll put you on the spot. I've finished my film. My film is supposed to come out March 26. My son's children book is coming out after coronavirus. What am I doing now, Stefan?
He's launching a book. He's in a movie. He's written a movie, Miles by Cyril. He's having his premiere when Corona's over.
You give the answer. I'm writing a book right now, and it's called If I Did It. It's called Pressure Makes Diamonds, If I Did It. That's the title of my book. Because if I did it, everybody can do it. All these things, I'm not doing it because I'm special. I'm not doing it because I'm different from you guys. I'm not doing it because I'm smarter. Don't go there. I'm doing it because I found my calling. When I moved to the US 12 years ago, I found my calling and I found my calling, understood my purpose, and I decided to stay in the journey, stay focused in the journey, all right? And now I'm making good use of time, because time is the most expensive commodity. If you don't use it, you lose it. So now that I'm home in the confinement, I don't just sit down all day turning my thumbs. I write my book. I'm publishing my son's book. I finish my movie. I'm doing some private screenings with some important people. No, I'm just kidding. But I find time to do this, right? And I have every 2 days, I have we have a meeting on Zoom with a group of students, you know, and we empower each other, you know? So you have to use time the right way, all right? And if I did it, you can do it. Most of you guys have awesome story, even better than mine. So why are you sitting on them? Why are you not writing a journal? Why are you not, it's free to publish a book on Amazon. It's free. You don't pay a dime. It's free. And if you want me to to read it over, I could do it. If you want, Jason, I'm sure all of us will be happy to edit your book for you. You know? Saint published 8 books. Saint Bako published 8 books, man. He's using time like a king. I love him. I love him to death. Like, he's doing so great. You know, and that's what I'm saying. The same spirit. We, in that generation, we came with the same fire. We came with the same spirit. All of us wanted to succeed, and we're trying one day at a time to grow. You know? So, the sky is not the limit. Jason, with your permission, I'm going to give, I want them to speak before we leave. The sky is not the limit. And I want, before we leave, I want a couple of you guys to tell me how you feel about today and how do you feel you're ready to, you know, to take over the world, you know? And I'm going to call names. I'm going to start with Brian. Brian is the first person I spoke to when I came on the chat. I connected with him. He looks like a good brother, man. And I know he's going to do great. Talk to me, Brian. How do you feel?
I feel great. I feel empowered. I feel like you made me realize, like, pressure is just an illusion in your mind to give yourself an excuse. So that's what pressure is. So we don't have no pressure. Pressure doesn't exist. So take the pressure off.
I love you, brother. I love you. I'm telling you. I love the way you put it, man. That's so powerful. Pressure is an illusion, right? Because it's like fear. It comes and it goes. But guess what? It makes diamonds. If you stay under the pressure, you become out refined. I love it. Thank you, Brian. I love it. Roxanne. Roxanne just jumped. Hey, Roxanne was here since. Roxanne, talk to us.
So I just want to thank you for your speech. It was really great. And you made me realize that for me, the pressure represents just the process to get where I want to be. So thank you.
Amen. Trust me, I didn't want to make it too complicated and too educational. I think there's time for that, but we have to be, the message have to be real down to earth for us to understand that this is all the people you see on TV and the people that are successful, they don't make any magic. It's the same people like you and I. Sometimes we just get lost in the illusion, the way Brian said, right? I will forget that there's something called real life,
right?
Right? So thank you, Roxanne. Estelle.
Oh, well. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Okay. First of all, I would like to say thank you so much for the wisdom and lessons that you shared with us today. Very inspirational, uplifting in this, you know, this time that we are in. And also, I would like to thank everybody who is participating. And Mr. Jason, thank you so much. This platform is very important to me, I'm sure, as everyone else. Well, I have, it's like I have so many dreams. I'm one of those, I feel my calling is to reach out to the, first of all, I wanna have my own school at home for underprivileged children, because when I went to Africa last year, I went back to back in 2 years, and I could see the need. And I'm one of those channels that God is using to reach to that population. And as you said before, like, your calling, you're gonna feel it. It's not gonna, you're not gonna feel the dragging, like, oh my gosh, I have to get up and go to that thing again. Oh, when am I gonna get paid? This is one thing that I can get up without even looking at the money or whatever that has to come with it. I just love working with children. And then I saw the need of, like, education out there. I'm like, okay, you know, once you have the education, nobody can take it away from you.
Yes,
so I want to be, I want to build my own school back home. And I'm here in America specifically for education. And I knew at one point that I'll go home once I acquire my master's, just like my two masters, and I'm off. But with this season, the corona, whatever this is, I don't know, the quarantine season, everything, for whatever reason, it has just become much clearer. I have timeline. I can see, like, okay, my master's, I'm gonna end here. And my PhD. I started planning for my PhD. I'm like, yes. And I can feel it within me. Like, yes, I'm going to do this. And I'm already planning for my PhD. So right now as I'm sitting, I know where I am and what exactly I want to do and exiting. I was talking to my mother just 3 days ago. I called her. I'm like, Mama, I want to build a house that I'm going to come live in. I have properties back home, like, you know, rentals and whatnot. So I say, I want to build like a bigger house and whatnot that I'm going to come live in. And she's like, oh, well, I say, I know now. I have a clear vision when I'm going to come home. And this is it. So, yeah.
So guess what? If I say I'm not proud of you, I'm lying. it feels like this, the way you're talking, I feel the passion, right? It means that it actually hits you. You know, it actually hit you. You finally understood that, you know, because sometimes we just want to take, because this is America, the opportunity is there. But when you turn around and look back, it hits you the way it hits you right now, and you're ready to make it happen. So I want to tell you, your destiny is in your hands, all right? And the way you felt it, never forget that feeling that you felt when you actually felt that I'm ready today to do it.
Yeah.
And you can do it.
Yeah, and, I just want to add more one point. I don't know if anybody knows, for the student, there's a professor, my professor for sociology. There's a CUNY, the Graduate Center, CUNY, of course. They have a program called Pipeline for PhD. Does anybody know about it? Yes. So that inspired me, because guess what? I'm getting stipend from it just being in the program, and they're paying 50% of my. So that's it. I'm done.
Thank you for the information.
Sure.
Trust me, you're awesome. Thank you. And please, even though you're going to go back, I want you to make sure to keep on inspiring other people in your surroundings, you know, for that fire that you have in you to continue burning, right? It should be contagious. It should be contagious, because not everybody have that instantaneous thing to pick it up and start running with you, with it. Right, so I want you to contaminate people with that. It's very important. Tiana.
Hi, everybody. I guess I'll just share what I wrote you then. I just wanted to say thank you to you, because I was in a weird place this week. And I guess I can share with you guys. I don't get down often, but when I do, it's a little weird for me, just because I'm so used to just being, I guess, like on 100. And definitely had like a moment. So I got accepted to my CUNY dream school, which is Sanjay.
Congratulations.
Thank you guys. My out of state option was HU. So I actually received my letter of acceptance to Howard University yesterday. And as happy as I was, because I got my dream school outside of New York, and then I got my dream school inside of New York, tough decision. And unfortunately, not that I'm unhappy, but I am a little just unhappy. My plans have changed. So I did plan to actually be in DC for the fall, attending HU. But unfortunately, due to this interesting time and the circumstances, I just didn't think it was a smart move to move out of New York and attend school in DC. And also the people that I was speaking to about reserving my place of living, because I was gonna do off-campus housing, it just, you know, it became a whole ordeal. And I understand as well the circumstances, like I couldn't even travel. I couldn't go see the places that I was supposed to quote unquote stay at or be residing with. So I just decided, you know what? I don't want to put my education on hold. It's very important to me, and I want to continue the momentum that I have. So I actually just submitted yesterday my acceptance to John Jay, and I said yes to them. So I will be attending this fall, John Jay, which I'm not too disappointed about, because I had already built a line of communication while I was at Hostos with John Jay. So I'm still going to be continuing to work with Hostos closely. I essentially will be a part of the Immigration Success Resource Center at John Jay. still trying to help the students at Hostos, just because I'm currently right now the president of the Hostos Dream Team Club. So I do hold my Dreamers and my undocumented DACA and international students very close to my heart, and I want to continue to serve them and continue doing the work essentially that I have been doing for the past year and a half while I've been at Hostos. So your words today kind of took me out of that weird place of like accepting the fact that sometimes your plan isn't always going to go according to plan. Mm-hmm. Things change, and when they change, it's not that it's the end of the world. You just have to find a way to adapt to the change and make the best of your situation. So I just decided after this Zoom session, I'm going to actually make an action plan to plant out my next following steps. I'm going to plant those seeds and see how my plant will grow.
I love it. I love it. Oh my God. I'm giving you a virtual hug right now. Guess what? My message for you is nothing happened by mistake. All right? You may think your joy was supposed, or your happiness was supposed to come from out of state, but the universe is telling you this is where something bigger is going to happen. All right? Mm-hmm. So I want to give you one advice. Open your eyes and look at that thing, because when God keeps you somewhere, he keeps you somewhere for a reason. You want to start looking at why did I stay here? The reason is way bigger than what everything is happening around me right now. Why did I stay? So find that reason, and I bet you're going to tell me I was right. It is for a reason. All right. So I'm so proud of you, and I'm happy that you didn't slow down because of that setback. Every setback doesn't come to set you back. Some setback comes to launch you further. Wow, that was powerful.
Yeah.
You guys write this down.
Thank you.
I can't believe I said that. Every setback doesn't come to stop you back. Some setback comes as launcher. Boom, and it launches you further. And you'll be shocked. How did that happen? So I'm proud of you. Sakina. Sakina.
Yes.
How are you doing? How do you feel?
I feel great. You know, last year I came to the conclusion that I work best under pressure. I work best having 1,000 things going on, because when I have that downtime, I lose my momentum. I get lost in the downtime, and I get lazy. I don't focus. So having learned that, I know that I need to get more into the community that I'm trying to be a part of and work and advocate for, because if I'm not in that community, hearing what's going on, whether it's at Hostos working with Brian or Kelvin, or trying to hear what's going on at the school, I need to hear those things so I know what I'm advocating for and who I'm trying to be as an advocate, or whether or not I'm going to go further in my education. You know, I was a little confused on whether I wanted to go into a master's and PhD program, but in order to be the voice and the change agent that I want to be, I know that I have to accomplish certain things, but I also have to stay busy and stay in the street and stay in the midst of the goings on, because that's how I work the best.
Sakina, I have something for you. You were always powerful. You didn't just notice that. All right. I know you, we've been places together. You've always been powerful, and I'm happy. You may think it's late that you're noticing that now, but you've always had that in you. You've always had that strength and that power in you. All right. I'm so happy now that you're actually using it. You're actually understanding how it works. And guess what? I'm here for you. If you need more advice, trust me, there's so much power in you that's why I didn't make out who he was in the beginning, because I was like, well, I'm not sure she's here. But just seeing you, the face comes back and I'm like, wow, this is a powerhouse right now. She just have to keep reminding herself how powerful she is. And that's for everybody. Sometimes you guys just have to remind yourself how powerful you are and pick up that mantle and run with it. Don't wait for someone to tell you. Just keep on going. All right? So trust me, the sky is not the limit, Sakia. You know that. Kevin was here throughout all this time, Mr. President. Oh my gosh. I'm so honored that the president was here and I was just running my mouth. Yeah, Kevin, tell me, how do you feel?
I feel great. I was taking notes and I was drinking coffee in the background.
Oh my gosh.
It's been a couple of days, so I didn't know if I looked good. So
you always look good, man, Mr. Vintage.
Likewise. So do you want me like to explain what I learned or like how I feel?
Yeah, how do you feel about it and how do you think you're going to move forward? I know you're already a great leader, you know, but every day there's always something new that pops up, you know, so.
You know, like honestly, I'm happy and I'm sad right now. Like I'm happy because it's like I have this time to work on myself and to refine myself, but I'm also sad because I miss the connections that I have with people outside of just my household or, you know, just outside of my room. And not only that, like, we had a whole plan, like, for the semester. So that kind of threw me off for a little bit because it was, like, I was so invested in that. And it was, like, I had my whole chessboard set up, per se. And then it was, like, boom, whole nother game. But, like, a few of you said, right, you have to learn to adapt. And that's something I've been pretty good at after a whole bunch of stuff in my life. And how am I going to move forward? I mean, honestly, what I started to do is I started to make my room like my office. I actually went to the school yesterday to pick up a few of my things and have like my whiteboard. I put my vision board up again, so I have to work on that again. I have my quotes. And I found myself slightly unmotivated when everything happened, honestly, like for a good week or so. Like I was just in like a weird kind of rut because I was just like, you know, I'm so used to working at school. I'm so used to being able to like walk around and do stuff, not only just with my brain, because when you sit behind a computer, you can effectively get work done, but it's different than the connections that you build in like real life and stuff like that. But I guess this is just a new form of life we have to adapt to for the time being. With that being said, I was listening to all of you and I was looking at all of you. It's really nice to see all of you and all. It's always good to be in a room or a Zoom full of leaders. And I miss USS. I know we're going to have our plenary meeting this Sunday, but I miss the whole, I learn from all of you. Even if I don't say it, I'll say it once in a while or I'll drop little hints, but I learn from everybody that I speak to, right? Like that's the whole reason I speak to people. So that I'm like a sponge. I try to take the best of people and I try to apply it to myself. So I myself can help the people around me, but also learn about the people around me so that I can help. The word leader to me is an interesting leader because when I was younger, I always knew that I was a little bit different, but I never knew because nobody told me what a leader was. I just knew that I wanted to effectively make change. And I know I'm going to graduate this year. And I think Muiz is still in the chat, if I'm not mistaken. And, you know, he's running right now. And I feel great about that because it was like a seed that was planted. Like, I knew because first time I saw him, he was like, you know, like I wanted to be president, you know, but he was just like, I'm just going to learn for right now and then I'm going to rise up. Same thing I did. And to know that I'm going to close this chapter of my life off really well and to see what happens afterwards, now I have to plan that because, you know, I was so invested in everything in school, but now school's about to be over, even though if I go to like a 4-year and stuff like that, but like I have to figure out what exactly are the steps in between that. And it always helps to speak or listen to people like you, especially. I've always admired you. Like I tell Jason or I tell a lot of you, like, even if I don't say it, but like I study people from afar. And right, because success leaves clues and people have different definitions of success. Like success for some people is monetary, but for me it's not necessarily monetary. It's, you know, the happiness that I can bring to myself but also to the people around me. And like I've always seen you, and I'm sure you've had bad days, but every time I've seen you, you've been, you know, courteous, a gentleman, happy, and you've always helped everybody around you.
Thank you.
And like I think that's really cool, while at the same time doing what you got to do to get what you got to do done. And like, I respect that, right? Because you were a man on a mission. You came over here, you did what you had to do, and you're still doing it. And I think that's really cool, you know, like, and you don't lose momentum. If I could have a tenth of the energy you have, I think I'd be all right. I've been kind of like a potato. I've gained a little bit of weight that I got to lose after.
Jason, give him the secret, Jason. Give Kevin the secret.
Kevin,
you don't want to drink. You don't have to drink what I drink. Trust me, it's too bitter.
Is it coffee?
No. This stuff took the plane from Africa, bro. You can't do that.
I'll drink it. I don't mind.
That's my energy. No, I'm just kidding. But thank you for your kind words. I admire you too, Kevin. You're a great leader, and thank you for the job you did at Hostos. And I know Jason will back me up with that. You know, you may not talk too much, but you act. You know, and I value people that act more than the talk. You know, because talk is cheap. You know, and you're one of those people that act, and I value that. You know, I've sent students to you. I've received great, you know, report about the way you treated them. This is lovely, you know, and your future is bright, bro. Just take your time. Not everybody, this is a marathon. It's not a fast race, all right? Everybody take their time and they make it when they were called to make it. So I value your time and I value everything that you did. Thank you. And if there's anything I can do to help, do not hesitate, bro. I'm here for that. Mustafa. How you doing, Mustafa?
Yes, sir. First of all, I want to thank you, man. Your words are really very, very inspirational, man. Like, a lot of what you said, you know, it's just very true and it's resonating with me. Now, in terms of being a leader or in terms of trying to, like, set up what you want for life, I think that one of the most important things is that every leader should have a set of values, morals that they follow. Some people, you know, they might succeed or they might move forward or they might be able to, you know, move past a certain point, but they break their morals and their values. And I want to ask you guys a question. Do you really think that that's success? If you break your morals, you break your own rules? I don't think it is. I believe that if you're a leader, you should have these guidelines and you should follow them. That's all I want to say, man.
Thank you. Thank you, Mustafa. And guess what? What you say makes a lot of sense. I am where I am today because of the values I set myself when I moved to the US. All right? If I didn't hold on to those values, I'll be somewhere else. All right? So it's very, very important that we know that it's very important to hold on to the values that you believe in, you know. And if you, as humans, right, we're interconnected. I want you guys to know that as humans, we're interconnected. If your values, if one of your values is not to be part of this humanity and be of use to this humanity, we have a problem. So thank you for saying that, Mustafa. Thank you. Raziel, my brother from another mother.
It's real, man. You know, it's always a pleasure listening to you, and you always have such wonderful things to say, man. So I definitely want to start off like everyone and just, you know, sing your praises, man. You know, like all of our interactions have always been just really times for us to build and get better as people and, you know, in our respective fields and where we want to go. So I guess I'll just, you know, kind of shift and segue to how I'm planning on making sure that I'm doing the best I can and being the best I can going forward. I do have a vision board like I had definitely alluded to earlier. I also want to say that, you know, my whole big thing is always making sure that I don't get lost in the shuffle with my entire life and the things that I do. I think a life is really defined by the dash in between, right? You know, the time you were born and then the time that you eventually perish, you know, the things that you hold dear, the things that you've done, the things that, you know, the impact that you've made. And every time someone reminds themselves of all the things that you've done, think back of just, you know, outside of just your life, but just little small events, microcosms of that. It's always the process. That's the idea, the process. And that's what the fond memories are established and forged. And I always want to make sure that I don't get caught up in just trying to reach the end and always trying to just make sure I get the success. It's about the grinds, you know, like those are the things that I love. And those are things that really challenge me to be the best person I can be. One of the things that I do is I'm a firm believer that networking in general doesn't just happen from, you know, the bottom up. Like, you know, like you always look for people that are in better positions for you, but it's side by side. For me, it's also down. You know, there are people that don't have, there are people that aren't able to, you know, just automatically go to college, maybe even get, you know, experiences, the things that I've experienced in my life. And while I've worked very hard for the things that I've gotten, my still goal is to make sure that it's easier for other people to get there. Because I don't believe the idea that some people have, and that's the way that they live life, that in order for you to be worthy in my eyes, you have to go through the same or similar type of thing. I feel like for me, that's counterproductive. If I can make it easier, even slightly, for someone who, you know, like may need it or who wants to do the same thing I'm doing, I'm going to do my best to do that. Currently, I mentor about 15 high school kids across the entire country. And I do that out of my own time in regards to no matter what I'm doing. They know that I'm dedicated to them because I care about them. I care about their success. I care about, like I just mentioned, trying to make it better for everyone else. And I think the best way to make yourself better is to make the world around you better. Because then at the same time, you get a chance to really reap the benefits of what change you've made. It doesn't always have to happen from the outward end. It does. You can manifest the things that you want to happen. Key idea and of course a key concept is the Leadership Academy. You know, like I am literally a product of that. Jason will tell you that. A few of you have already seen me from the inception. Absolutely where I am right now. You know, like the great thing about everything that I've, you know, had the chance to be a part of is I've always shared that with other people. It's never happened in a vacuum. And I know Stefan loves me when I say that, you know, but it never happens in a vacuum. Again, it's true. There's nothing that I've ever achieved where I didn't get some type of help or I didn't absorb some type of lesson from someone. We are not just isolated individuals. We are living on a planet. It's living, it's breathing. There are people around us who are doing the exact same thing. So the greatest thing I think you can give to someone, and what I would plan on doing to be successful, is thinking outside of myself and being as empathetic as I possibly can. You know, like, and I think that you guys are all wonderful because you're here, and that's something that we share. And I share this again, this statement with you guys, and this is just, you know, a testament to how much we're going to be great, and the things that we do will affect people. So throw my you know, like the, you know, the long story short is, I'm going to make sure that I uplift as many people as possible on my way to the top.
I love it, bro. You know, I've been in your life in times where it was really tough. And I'm so, to me, it's an honor. When I see, anytime I see you, I'm happy to see you because I've been there when the pressure was tough and I'm seeing the diamond right now. All right. So that is the testament of what I just spoke about. Right. You know, we've been into like there, and that's just beautiful because guess what? Just hearing you speak to me is just awesome. You know, it's just that feeling that I said I felt when I graduated my master's, because I'm like, wow, I actually did it, you know, and now he's giving back. Like, there's nothing better than that, you know. So thank you guys for that. And Isabel, how you doing? Unmute yourself or, yeah, talk to me.
Thank you so much. I'm good. Thank you so much. Thank you for teaching us. I'm feeling very happy because I'm learning a lot for this lesson. Thank you so much.
Oh, Isabel, you're the best. Thank you. Marita, talk to me. He texted a lot. I saw you texting.
Can you guys hear me?
Yes, ma'am, we can.
I'm so sorry. I know I have texted a lot. I was multitasking, listening to your workshop, and
that was awesome.
Doing other important stuff that I had to get done, but I was paying attention, and I just want to thank you so much for your inspiring words. You motivate me that I'm going to keep going my education, and also what touched me the most is that, you know, you said that pressure, you know, you get to the diamonds, and that's true, because of right now what's going on, you know, I was having a lot of anxiety when this all happened. I suffer from a lot of anxiety, and also I was thinking, so if I'm transitioning to distant learning, how will I process all this? Because I have a learning disability, I have dyslexia as well, so I was so nervous, but I am adapting to it very well. Mm-hmm. And this is my last semester, and I'm like, I'm not going to let this stop me. Marissa's going to graduate. She's going to graduate her associate's, and she's going to keep on with her bachelor's. And right now I'm in the process of transferring all my information to Lehman. So right now I'm about to meet up with my academic advisor, I believe in 2 more weeks. We're gonna do a Zoom meeting. So from there she can help me with the process of registering for courses for the fall semester. So I feel like I'm doing good. Yeah, everything's doing good. And you know, like even though graduation has been postponed, I'm still glad that we're all going to graduate as the class of 2020. It's not going to be now, but we will celebrate, you know, and we will get through this pandemic together. So, you know, this represents us being strong and, you know, in our toughest time of the world, we're still being strong. We're still holding it together and we're going to get through this together, you know? So yeah, thank you so much. I really appreciate
it. Marita, I want to thank you. Trust me. Do not thank. I want to thank you for being there. You know why? Because you said something that reminds me of someone that's dear to me. And that's Stephanie Caban. Stephanie Caban is a good friend of mine. She's been part of this program. She's been through a lot, and she always told me, just like you said, because I suffer with dyslexia, I have this, I have that. And I kept telling her, I said, guess what? You have all those things, but you have something else in you, and that's strength. You know, and the fact that you're graduating with everything that you just said, it already dismantle every thesis that we could have about someone that have dyslexia, right? So these are labels, but the labels are not going to hold you down because your mindset is strong. Your mindset is powerful. You know, I'm not saying it's not real, but I'm saying it's labels. You can either let them hold you down or you can take them and run with them. And you decided to take them and run with them. And guess what? You're doing it, all right? You're an advocate, not a victim. You're doing it. So there's tons of women out there that will come out and say, I have dyslexia, but guess what? You're going to tell them, even though I had that dyslexia, I graduated from hostels with my associate, and I'm at Lehman doing my bachelor's. And guess what? They're going to look at you and say, wow, if Marita did it, I can do it. So that's what we're talking about. That's your purpose, all right? So I'm proud of you, and I value the time you took out to be here right now, because that's a testament of who you are as a leader. That's a testament of who you are as a person, all right? And this is just the beginning. So trust me, I love it. I love everything you said. This is powerful. This is seriously powerful. Yanira, who is she? Who is that? Who's Yanira? This is strong, Marita. Congratulations again. Yanira, Ala, Kabira. Yanira is on. Ala is on. Kabira, you on? If it's Kabira is on, let's go. Talk to us.
I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Sorry. I'm multitasking, cooking. I have my son and everything. That's why my video has been turned off.
No, that's fine.
Right now, I'm currently doing my master's in higher education, which I am passionate about and I love. And I'm grateful to Jason for the opportunity to be able to do my practicum with the Leadership Academy. Because this experience has been life-changing. Interacting with all of you students has been life-changing. Being able to meet people like Cyril in New York has been absolutely amazing. The one question that I wanted to ask you is, what do you do when you start to lose momentum, or like when you feel like I'm stuck? Because with everything that's going on, and for some of you who don't know, my husband is a doctor and currently working with COVID patients. And with everything that's going on, it's very easy to lose the momentum of what you're focusing on, what your drive is, what your passion is, when it feels like everything around you is kind of crumbling. I'm supposed to be graduating in August, and I don't see the light at the end of the tunnel just because of everything. Like I had a meeting with my professor this morning, and I was talking to him about a 20-page paper that I have due on Sunday. And I'm like, you know, I have this vision of what I want to complete and how it's supposed to look, but I have no idea how to get there. And because to me, I was like, the thing that's stopping me that's in between me and graduation is this paper. And he's like, oh, okay, well, then I'll just grade you based off of this conversation. Don't worry about finishing the paper. And I'm like, that's amazing and a relief off my shoulder. But then also still trying to get out of that mindset of being stuck in one place or being paralyzed by fear. So how do you navigate that?
All right, I'm going to ask you a question. Is your husband doing this by calling? Does he love being a doctor?
Absolutely.
Okay, so you don't need to worry, all right?
Yeah.
You don't need to worry because God takes care of his children. If your husband is doing this by calling, it means he was made for this time.
This is actually his specialty. So, yeah.
Exactly. So you, guess what you have to be? You have to be the support system that he needs, because you're not in the pressure that he is right now.
That's true.
You are in the comfort of the house, cooking, taking care of your son, being on a Zoom chat. And that guy is out there, you know, navigating through the virus and all that. Guess what? Yeah. What he needs and deserves is you right now. So there's no room for you to be stressed or be down and trying to get stuck or everything. No, you should look up to tomorrow because your husband is a superhero. Your husband is, he doesn't have a cape, but he's a Superman right now. So when all this is died down, guess who are the people we're going to be clapping for? People like him. So you will be standing beside him getting all that credit because he didn't do it by himself. He could not do it by himself if you didn't have the power that you have as a strong, powerful leader to be there for him.
Thank you.
All right, so there's no reason for you to get stuck. You're supposed to look at that and say, wow, if that guy is out there putting his life on the line, then I should be here doing what I need to do and moving forward. Because at the end of the day, we're going to be sitting down and just enjoying ourselves. All right, so I don't need to tell you what I do when I get stuck. I need to tell you what you have to do right now. And I know you're going to do it because you are a strong woman. You are a strong leader. Look at all those stuff we spoke about right now, about him being out there, about him loving what he's doing and being there for these people that need him. And then you being that anchor that's holding him down right now.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not going to go deep into spirituality and everything, but you know what a wife is for your husband. You know, if you're not powerful, then you're bringing his powers down. All right.
Well, I don't want to do that.
Exactly. So you want to keep pushing him up. You know what I mean. So yeah. I truly understand that you were at a place that you were psychologically, but guess what? You didn't just remind yourself what a superwoman you are. You know, sometimes we just have to reset and remind ourselves how powerful we are. The moment you remind yourself, I have the power, guess what? All is gone. Because it's a feeling. Feeling comes and feeling go. When you hold on to it and make it a mindset, then it becomes a problem. But when it just comes and goes, it's a feeling. And then when you tell your mind, I guess what, Tabira, you're not going to think about this today. I'm not going to be fearful because I know everything happens for a reason. I'm going to sit down. I'm going to recreate everything around me. Everything is going to be straight. Everything is going to happen straight. Did that answer your question? Are you satisfied with that? Or do you?
Yeah, no, that's an excellent answer. Because
I'm not going to tell you what you want to hear. I'm going to tell you what is real.
No, that is real. That is what I needed to hear.
Because so if I tell you what you want to hear, it's just going to be a band-aid on the wound. But if I tell you what is real, it's going to hurt you a little bit. But guess what? It's going to wake you up and you're going to be the powerful woman that you are already.
Yeah. Thank you.
All right. So I don't know how we're doing on time, Jason, but I wanted to give everybody the ability to speak. So you tell me if we're good. Who am I missing? Elzibos. Who's Elzibos? Mohammed Bey, you have a voice? Can you say something?
Yes, I do.
All right. The floor is yours, brother.
Okay. Hello, everyone. Peace be upon you. Thank you for your time. Thank you for your lesson. One of the major things that I took away from this is that pressure is not an affliction, it's an opportunity to improve. And
so can you say that again? I didn't hear you.
I said pressure is not an infliction, it is an opportunity to improve.
I love that.
And what you said had touched me because me, myself, I didn't finish high school. I went from a GED to being Phi Theta Kappa. So, and it hasn't been a long road. It wasn't easy. So I understand how pressure can make you evolve and adapt because adaptation is how the human race is here today. So very powerful. Thank you.
I love it. I love it, brother. I love it. The quiet people are always more powerful. I love it. That was great. I love it. Moise is next to you. So the floor is yours, Moise. Thank you again for your participation, Mohammed.
Can everybody hear me?
Yes.
Okay. First of all, I'd like to thank Cyril. You know how much I appreciate you, so I'm not going to thank you all night. everybody knows. I mean, for me, the reason why I admire him is because some of the sessions that I go into, when I see people that I respect talk greatly about Cyril, it is an attestment to how great an individual he is. So I don't need to go back and forth to tell everybody how amazing he is. He's been a mentor for the, I believe, past 2 weeks. I just joined this group and it feels like I've been there since forever. And I would like to thank you for taking the time to talk to us today. What I took from today, like very many of your sessions, remember when we were having conversation at the other group and you saw the similarities between you and me in terms of the high school history, the high school misfit, and you know the past. And for me, when I see somebody that has similar background, similar stories as I have had, and I could see those people, and not only you, I know personally also Kelvin, I know stories of Kelvin and other former presidents. When I see those people in successful and powerful positions and in great spirits, it gives me the confidence that as long as I keep my head down and I surround myself with these people, I could also get to the place of comfort. And you told me the last time when we were talking, when I talked about my aspirations of being, president of my country, and you said start doing right now, and I told you about the foundation. I probably should update you on another group, but I'll probably tell you at the other group, but I started something new as well, and I have been doing, like you've asked. I've kept on doing, and I only want to do, I don't want to talk anymore, like you said, and I want to influence as much as possible. As far as pressure, I'm just like the lady, I believe her name was Sekina. I work best under pressure. Anyone that know me, they could testify to this. When everything feels like it's against me, I feel like a genius. Then I start to calm down and I strategize. And pressure sometimes is good. Everyone could define it to however they see fit. I feel like people define it differently. For me, like she said, when there's no pressure and everything is going on too smoothly, I start to get, which maybe is not a very good attribute. I feel like you should always be relentless, regardless of pressure or no pressure. And I'm always trying to grow as a man. I'm trying to grow as a leader as well. Maybe one of the things that I need to work on is being consistent, you know, pressure or no pressure. I guess that's how to put it. And I believe you walked me through that phase. I would like to appreciate Jason. I think everybody knows how amazing Jason is. He doesn't ever take credit, like you said. But these leadership workshops, these little, meetings that I have, I don't take them for granted. Loose Lady could testify today. I wasn't going to make it, but then I remembered Cyril was coming. Even though I could call you personally to ask for questions, I knew any session you had to be, I had to just go and listen. And as far as I'm concerned, and not just for you or for everybody listening, for me personally, I'll continue to do whatever it takes to grow as a man, as a leader, and most importantly, as a member of the community around me. So there are a lot of things that I cannot discuss on this platform, but obviously, hopefully when we have a one-on-one, I appreciate the fact that most of the people that I see a lot in school, that I know in school, I don't know them in depth. I feel like this one meeting made me know a lot of people on a much more deeper level. Like, you know, when people share personal stories, and again, I can't take these sessions for granted, and I appreciate every single body in the group, and hopefully, you know, I mean, this is going to continue, obviously, but hopefully we all continue to grow and continue to learn and be the leaders that we all seem to be.
We hold Jason accountable to make him continue that. So
we should be accountable for our own growth.
Yeah, Jason has no life, so we hold him accountable. He's going to continue that. Are we missing anyone? Mel, Andy, and Kenya, Azu? Somebody, none of them have ever, they didn't speak. Mel, are you on? Okay, Ola, Olaum, Olaun Mia Jibola, are you on?
Hi, yeah, I'm on.
Okay, how you doing, Ola?
I'm good, hi, hello everybody. So one of the things that you said that really stood out to me was the fact that when you said, when you have a mission, you also have to enjoy the journey.
Mm-hmm.
Because me and my mother was having a conversation like that the other day, how life is like fragile, but all because nobody knows when they're going to die doesn't mean that you don't work towards your accomplishment.
Exactly.
You have to set yourself up to where you want to be in life and your comfortability and your purpose. So it's interesting how the universe is like connected and you're discussing this topic today.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know you personally, but I really enjoyed your conversation. I felt like you spoke on a lot of like powerful things. And I felt like I was just at church because you were preaching.
Wow, that's great. I feel great, man. I feel empowering to hear that. I wasn't in your house when you were talking with your mom. I think I was a little fly on the wall, but I'm just kidding. Yeah, but that's how the universe tells you that what you're saying is actually there to make you grow. When you hear it on a second time and a third time, people, different people that were not there saying the same thing. So it's important to enjoy the process while focusing on the goal, you know. And I thank you that you were here, and I thank you that you you took something out of it, and I hope this could be the beginning of something greater.
Yeah, thank you so much. I really do appreciate the lesson. Thank
you. That's great. Stefan Juviela.
The person that loves talking the most, you leave him for last. I really appreciate that, brother. But before I even start, I think it's really inspiring. I just hearing all of your stories and sharing this time with you, I don't take it for granted. I don't take any of you for granted. My brother Raz, I really appreciate seeing you here in this capacity. And honestly, it's been a while. So I missed you, bro. I was remarking to my friend Alyssa, who's watching along with me on my phone, I was remarking to her that, you know, we have heard all this before, and it was extremely important for me to listen to the information again, because I think Cyril tells us in our other group, when you hear something more than once, that means it's confirmation. You know what I mean? So I think that this confirmed a lot to me about my journey into leadership and what my calling in being an advocate is. And I know that I've been really in this very thoughtful place this entire time, really trying to get a sense of not only the man that I am, but the leader, the person that I am. And it's been a difficult journey, but I think I'm getting closer to that place of becoming refined. I think that pressure for me, it is, and I'm gonna be completely honest here because I'm being recorded, obviously, and a lot of you do know me personally. Pressure breaks me sometimes. And now I'm beginning to adjust to feeling that pressure and having that pressure and utilizing it to move forward. Some of you know that I wasn't in school. A big update is that I'm going back to school. I have two choices on what school that I get to go to in the fall. And that's gonna be an amazingly big decision. That's not only that, there's just so many things that are moving forward for me. And I feel like it's because I've finally gotten out of my own way and realized it's not about myself. I think one of the most important things that you've talked about was servant leadership. And I think that we've all touched on it in one way or another. It's not about you. It's about those that are behind you. It's about lighting the way for them. And that's a lesson that Jason tried to teach me 3 years ago when we went to Brooklyn and I was pushing a door, a elevator button. And I thought it was such a bad job. And he was like, do you know, just by you doing this, you're helping somebody? And that was like my first major lesson in leadership from Jason. And that I've been able to replicate that and continue to do that over and over and over again. And I'm just so inspired. Like when I see Raz, who went from being a member of the academy that I interviewed, which was amazing, to an SGA president to where he is now, it's just, it's inspiring. And I really appreciate him, but I also appreciate all of you, because I'm seeing most of you guys, and I know most of you guys, and I've been mentored by most of you guys, and I've been cared for by most of you guys. So I do have to honestly say thank you to each and every one of you. Sakina, I love you. I miss you. I just want to say thank you from the bottom of my heart. I'm not going to cry over here or anything, but I'm just grateful for all of you guys. So thank you so much.
Welcome. We're not missing anyone, right? Mel, are you there? Mel Andy is not there. Okay. So I think everybody spoke. Leah?
Who's playing? Leah. Listen.
Who's that? Who's speaking?
Luz Lady, do we get her?
No, Luz Lady texted me. She's doing something and it's noisy. So okay,
and Leah Mel?
Leah Mel, Elsie Boss.
Okay.
Kenya Azu, Stefanik. Okay, so we're good. Guys, I want to thank you very much. And anytime I speak, and for those that have been in my speech, I get hyped. Like, I can't go down of this high anymore because it's like we've shared energy, you know. And I want you guys to, I want that same energy that I'm feeling right now to get transferred into you. If you don't come out of this with a new idea, you don't come out of this with a new opportunity, you don't come out of this with a new something, you didn't lack time, you lack discipline, all right? Because now you have time in your hand. You're confined in the house, you're quarantined, you're not going anywhere. So now is the time for you to start something. Write a book, do a drawing. For those that are talented, do something, write a song. Do whatever you want to do, but come out of this quarantine with something new. Brian, I don't know, write a rap. I don't know what you want to do, Brian, but do something. You know, do something. Come out of this to something new, right? So at the end of the day, you look at that time, you don't say, wow, I spent all this time in the house and I didn't do nothing. No, I did something right. It's easy for time to go fast when you're just indoors and you're not doing anything. So I please urge you guys, and I'll leave you with this. I urge you to use this time wisely so that you can actually come out of this with something, you know, more than what you were doing. And remember that you are a servant. You're not doing this for you. You're doing this for everybody that was called to be there for you. And for those that need to stay in touch, Jason will give you guys my information. And I'm always willing to be there for everybody. Thank you so much for your time, and guys, for your kind words and for just being there. Jason, you're the man. You know how much I love you, man.
Thank you, Cyril. Thank you everybody for being here. Stay safe, and we'll see you next week. I'm not going to be kind of like preaching right now.
Are we doing a group picture or no?
I took some pictures during. So.
Oh, that reminds me, Jason. Who posted that picture of me looking like I was ready to fight someone?
That was Jason. That was a total Jason thing. I'm blaming him right now. That was Jason. He does it to everybody. It's a Jason.
Jason, I will charge you for that.
You have to take Saints rule. The rule is you have to always know that I'm in the room and have to be ready and pose no matter when I'm in the room.
That's the rule. I saw the picture. I posted it. I was like, wow, that picture looks like I was ready to fight somebody. But it's okay. Is that right? I'm not going to complain.
You look very intense.
It was. I was like, somebody's about to get hurt.
Passionate, man. That's all right. No passion never hurt.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Thank you, guys.
All right. Thank you, everybody.
Take care.
Thank you. Have to go to class.
Thank you, everyone. Take care and stay healthy and safe.
Bye. Thank you so much again. See you.
Thanks for a great workshop.
Bye, Steele.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. Thanks for a great workshop. Appreciate it. Everyone stay healthy and safe.
Thank you.
Mr. Professor.
Who are you talking to?
I was talking to Cyril. He dipped out on me.
Professor.
Yeah, I called him Professor. Professor Liefeld, how are you?
I'm all right. How are you?
I'm doing all right, boss.
I need to figure out how to save this now.
Oh, man. Like, save it like you save those bad pictures of us. Make it happen, boss. Oh man, I miss you, boss. It's been interesting. I miss you, boss.
I miss you guys too.
Oh man, Brian's sitting here. Brian's like the most refined member of the SJA. He's sitting there listening to everything. He's the greatest words you ever heard. Go ahead, Brian.
No, I'm just saying everything. I'm just inspired by everything. Like, you know. On a daily basis. It doesn't take much for you to be inspired. So being that we was in a whole form of inspiration, it was like I had to take it all in.
That's my brother right there. That's my brother.
I don't know how to say it.
I don't know, boss. I was about to cry for you today. I feel like your crying is contagious now. Now I'm crying for everything. Like I literally got emotional when I saw like Roz, I got emotional because it's like, and then Kelvin, and then everybody, it's just like, wow, these people are not going to be here. It's weird.
So,
boss, did you figure out how to save it?
No.
Damn. It's still recording, by the way. I just want to
make sure.
I
know it is.
We're running over time.
What about that icon that says share content?
No, that's to share content on his computer, so he'll start sharing his documents, like all the recommendation letters he's been writing and stuff. Like, he can't, doesn't want to do that.
let's see.
Well, I saw you throw on the USS.